further ado, my name is Dr. Amanda Probst-Cuevas, and I am privileged to serve as the Director of the Office of Appreciative Education in concert with Dr. Jenny Bloom and our wonderful team of interns on our team. And we are so happy to welcome you to today's webinar entitled A Celebration of Recent Scholarship on Appreciative Education, during which time we will hear from six practitioner scholars who have recently conducted dissertation studies on a topic related to appreciative education. And it is such an exciting day. And I want to turn it over to Dr. Jenny Bloom to welcome you all as well. Jenny.
Thank you, Amanda. I was telling the panelists earlier when we got on that for me, this is literally a dream come true, this webinar, because it wasn't so long ago, 2002, that the first article about appreciative advising was published, and my co-authors, Bryant and Jane, on the Appreciative Advising Revolution book, when we were dreaming big dreams way back when, this was one of our dreams, that we would have webinars and we would have opportunities for people who were conducting research related to appreciative advising, appreciative education, to share their research. So I personally want to thank our amazing panelists today for joining us today to share their work, because it really is a dream come true for me. So I'll hand it back to you, Amanda. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Jenny. You covered, I'll pick up where you left off. As Jenny mentioned, you know, this month marks a really special time in the Office of Appreciative Education. We're almost 20 years from when Jenny's seminal article was published, as she just mentioned. And within these 20 years, the literature on the topics of appreciative advising and appreciative education has burgeoned. And so we're seeing an increased number of articles being published and dissertations written annually. And I know Brian's going to be dropping a link into the chat that will link you to some of the compiled literature for those of you who may be interested in delving deeper. We encourage you to bookmark that link. And it really is such a joy to see how the appreciative advising theory to practice framework continues to positively impact not only students, but also the practitioners and the institutions that adopt it. Just last week, we were honored to have appreciative advising framework designated as a recommended model in the newest What Works Clearinghouse Practice Guide entitled Effective Advising for Post-Secondary Students. And I believe Brian is going to drop a link to that document in the chat. For those of you who haven't yet accessed this resource, we encourage you to do so. So it indeed is an exciting time in the history of the Office of Appreciative Education and in the appreciative education movement. And we are delighted that each of you has taken the time to join us today to learn from and celebrate with our panelists. So we hope that you'll be encouraged and inspired to conduct research of your own. And without further ado, let me go over the format of today's webinar. What we're going to be doing is spending the first 30 minutes having each of our distinguished guests share a 5-minute overview of their dissertation, which, let me tell you, y'all, this is a really high task. It's really difficult to condense years of research into 5 minutes, but I know that each of our panelists is up for the task, and the idea is to give you a taste in a quick, brief overview of what they covered. And then we're going to move into breakout sessions for about 15 minutes, where you will have an opportunity to learn more deeply from one of the panelists that you choose from and engage in a Q&A session. That Q&A session will be facilitated by one of our Appreciative Ambassadors, which is the Appreciative Ambassadors is a registered student organization at FAU affiliated with our office. And each of our students is trained in the appreciative advising framework, and I know that you'll enjoy getting to know each of them. And then we will, after the breakout sessions, we'll rejoin in the main session to close out the webinar. So without further ado, I would love to welcome Dr. Chris DeGeer to share his work.
Thank you so much, Amanda. I'm honored to be in such great company here today. So I decided as I was working through as a faculty member on some grant programs that our students needed some additional wraparound support. And we at that point adopted a proactive approach to advising, but we also had appreciative advising being implemented in our TRIO program. Most of our students just received prescriptive advising. So I was really interested in the impact on these developmental advising approaches. And that's really what started my dissertation research. So as I stated, I was really curious, most specifically, does appreciative advising improve college student completion? Similarly, does the proactive or intrusive advising approach make any impact on that? And then diving a little deeper on the qualitative side, I wanted to know what are the common themes found in the interactions between advisors in these developmental approaches and their advisees, hopefully to extract some additional context around the impact on outcomes. So being in a Midwestern community college, we're in a rural setting here, I had access to this population of students that participated in various advising programs. All of them received prescriptive advising. Our advisors worked briefly with them on a set of courses they needed. But some select students, as I mentioned, in our TRIO program received appreciative advising. And these students participating in a Department of Labor program were returning adults looking to reskill. And they were participating in this proactive advising that we wrapped around them. This was the fall semester of 2014 when we had all three programs running at the same time, and I was able to look at the data behind 1,145 students over that time frame to completion. Of those, I followed up with surveys, and 17 students responded to provide that additional context. So what I found as I conducted this multinomial logistic regression was that students who received these appreciative advising interventions were ultimately three times more likely to complete their studies. And that actually resulted in three times across different timeframes, 100, 150, or 200% of time to completion versus not graduating at all. Similarly, the prescriptive advising was used as a baseline. So this is really in context of our general student population. They were three times more likely to complete. Those who received a proactive advising intervention, that group didn't actually see any gains in their 100% time to completion, but they were five times more likely to complete in 150 or 200% time. So then as I dove really into this questionnaire, survey questionnaire, I identified some key themes related to an appreciation for course selection and specifically help with planning out their sequence of courses. There's also a theme of the caring and support that students felt that they received from their advisors. Some students did indicate that they had a certain level of independence and may not have felt that they needed that direct intervention from their advisors. But really across the board, they definitely indicated that their interactions with their advisors contributed to improved outcomes and specifically assisted them with on-time completion. So what really we can imply from this is kind of obvious, but we should work to expand effective academic advising. And I use the term effective specifically because that's not necessarily the same for all students. I do believe that differentiated advising approaches based on this research are warranted to really meet the students where they are and to provide that. But I also think that within any different framework of advising, there are ways that we can incorporate appreciative inquiry based on maybe it's the frequency of advising or the requirement for advising that might change. But underlying that with that really appreciation for strengths and helping to build on what students have achieved to help them see their end goals through, really kind of the outcome there. What I'd be interested in for any aspiring scholars is to think about what are the more useful components within each of these advising models and kind of diving deeper into what is most effective and then what types of students benefit from most components, because we don't necessarily see the benefit equal across different demographic groups. So definitely some exciting opportunities for future research, and it certainly supports the existing literature that appreciative inquiry is an effective approach to advising.
Excellent. Chris, thank you so much for sharing an overview of your work. Your findings are absolutely compelling, and I concur with you on your recommendations. So thank you for sharing.
Thanks so much.
Next, absolutely. Next, I would love to invite Dr. Valerie Harper to share her work. And I have to share with you that when Valerie, before Valerie started her dissertation work, she reached out to Jenny and myself asking if this is something that she could explore. And we fully supported her engagement. And so this is such, I have to say, I'm truly honored to see you at this place that we get to celebrate your work because we've been with you from start to finish. So Dr. Harper.
Thank you, Amanda. Good morning, everyone. What inspired me to conduct this research was previously I was an academic advisor, and I was trying to look for a topic on what to do with my dissertation and was told to weed my own backyard. So I always loved academic advising, and I came across appreciative advising one day on the computer and start researching. And that's what led me to reach out to Jennifer and Amanda. And I never thought they would get back to me. You know, you reach out to someone and go, oh, they're too famous. They're not gonna get back to me. But they were so kind, they got back to me and stayed with me the whole time. So I thank them. And then next, I'm sorry, Amanda, next slide. The research questions. What I did is I looked at the research questions and wanted to figure out how does appreciative advising really build a relationship with African-Americans students, because you would hear every day from the African-American students that they did not feel comfortable with advisors, and they could tell the advisors didn't feel comfortable with them in the room. So I wanted to reach out and see how they could build authentic relationships as they intersected with non-cognitive barriers and non-academic barriers. And I thought through the tools of appreciative advising that may work. As far as the sample, I did a qualitative research and semi-structured interviews. And I had 11 academic advisors who I must say were certified by the Appreciative Advising Institute, and I really appreciated it. You had to be certified by the Advising Institute, and you had to have a year or two more experience in it to participate in my research. So I had 7 males and 4 females who agreed. Of them, 6 were white and 5 African-Americans. And they worked in 3 to 15 years of advising. Moving right along. And what I found was the judgment-free zone. I thought we could go a little bit more into detail about what that exactly meant. What does that mean to be in a judgment-free zone in a safe space? How do you really make someone feel safe when you're sitting across from them? And also, how do you make them safe if the advising is considered they're in a silo by themselves? Do they have the power? So how do you get that power? The advisors almost have to create that power within their space to empower students to succeed. And there was something I wanted to say. The intentional, you had to be intentional. And I felt to be intentional and to have social justice, you had to recognize inequalities. If you don't recognize the inequalities, how can you offer a judgment-free zone to students of color? And I looked at the touch points. And then, as I said, the counteracting barriers were empowering the students and active listening. But how do we get that across to students? Next slide. And in my findings, I felt that appreciative advising met all the standards, but maybe if we increase critical race theory, the cycle of socialization, microaggression. So not to say that someone has to reevaluate themselves as an advisor, but reflect on historical aspects that have affected African-American students or students of color. A lot of people say you stick to unconscious bias, but how can you really know if you're not sure of the history? You have to know history. So I felt that that should be included. And then understanding and knowing there are reasons for African-American students' attrition rate. If you do the history and the background, you'll see attrition rate for African-American students still is high. So how can we affect that and at least turn it around, have some impact? And I think the appreciative advising offers that. One thing I'd like to add is I did try this a little bit on some Caucasian advisors I have here. And interesting enough, they said, well, I don't know what they do when they leave my office. So, and they had no idea of the history and said they didn't have time to even know. So that's another thing that really made me look into appreciative advising. Thank you, Amanda.
Thank you, Dr. Harper, for sharing your great work and for continuing to challenge us that as we aspire to create caring environments, right? Caring communities, that part of creating that caring community is being aware of the history, right? That has impacted the students we are privileged to serve. So thank you for challenging us to continue to get better at what we do. So thank you. Mm-hmm. Next, I'd like to invite Dr. Roy Kaplan, one of our former interns in the Office of Appreciative Education, to present his work. Roy.
Thank you, Amanda. It's such an honor to be here, everyone. The influence and motivation behind my research stems from personally attending the 2015 Institute myself. I was a young academic advisor about a year into the position, and I was suffering from burnout, and I was just bogged down. The job was great, but I was definitely being exposed to parts of academic advising that were causing me to just be bogged down every day at work. This wasn't me alone. Some of my colleagues that attended from Florida Atlantic were experiencing the same phenomenon. I attended the 2015 Institute, and it really rejuvenated my career to this day, really. But especially long term, I saw a change in my attitude, both at home and in the workplace. So I wanted to see if this phenomenon could happen across the board. So moving on to my research questions, they all focused on the 2018 Institute. I conducted my research there. On the short term influence of attending the Appreciative Advising Institute, the long term potential influence on attending the Appreciative Advising Institute. So my foundation for my research stems from Seligman's well-being model. It's called PERMA, broken into and he breaks well-being into five different areas: positive emotion, engagement, positive relationship, meaning, accomplishments, and achievement. And then Butler and Kern created a survey instrument to understand if, in a survey. So I used this survey at the 2018 Institute, which consisted of 123 academic advisors attending the Institute. So for the definition of academic advisor, to make it all encompassing for all of the participants at the Institute, it was pretty open-ended. So that just doesn't mean academic advisor. That means it could potentially be a trio representative, career services, kind of across the board. So that was my sample for the Institute of 123 academic advisors. And then moving on into my key findings, there was short-term influence in attending the Institute, both in workplace well-being and overall. But I think the truly significant finding that came out of this was long-term influence on attending the Institute. So right after the Institute, one part of my well-being model was showed significance in attending the Institute. But then long-term, when we reissued the survey, it grew to four out of the five areas of the well-being model. So in the workplace, positive emotion, engagement, and relationships increased 1 month post the Appreciative Advising Institute, while only meaning increased right after the Institute. So advisors got back into their office, they reflected on the Institute, so their work started, their routine started, but then, you know, they potentially started seeing some of the influence of attending the Institute, and these areas of well-being did an increase in them, you know, once they got back into the office long-term. And so for my recommendations of practice, I didn't mention this. This was a quantitative study. So institutions looking to address overall and workplace well-being of their employees can do so by sending advisors to the Appreciative Advising Institute. And this is across the board for demographics. We had a wide range of participants for the 2018 event. But knowing that all Appreciative Advising Institutes are unique and evolve. So the 2018 Institute was a little different than the 2019 Institute and so forth. And it was a unique number that year. So, you know, coming in with an open mind and understanding that this is going to be a unique experience for your advisors that attend.
Excellent. Thank you, Roy, for sharing that. And one, I love what you found about meaning and how that has a longer term effect on overall well-being. It kind of creates this kind of spiral effect, a little domino effect. But beyond that, I love that you've been able to highlight that the Appreciative Advising Institute can be an effective intervention to bolster and facilitate workplace and overall well-being. So that's really powerful. Thank you for sharing. And without further ado, Jim Disrude, I'd love to invite you to share your findings.
All right, thanks, Amanda. Good morning, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jim Disrude, and I'm the Director of Student Success at McHenry County College in Crystal Lake, Illinois. It's an honor to share with you the findings of my dissertation completed at Arizona State University entitled Examining the Implementation of Appreciative Advising and Its Relationship to Community College Students' Intent to Persist. This is a qualitative action research study, meaning that this is participatory research in which a researcher identifies a problem of practice at their own institution, studies it, and then in a pragmatic fashion, puts forward an action plan to try to solve it. And the roots of this project started in 2019. I had just started at MCC and we received a Department of Education grant. And as part of this grant, one of the goals was to improve student satisfaction with academic advising. And we decided that the Appreciative Advising model was one of the great things we could implement to do that. So to guide the study, let me show you the research questions here that we use for the guardrails to do this implementation, but then also make it a product of the dissertation. First, we wanted to see what are the perspectives of students who participate in the Appreciative Advising program. And secondly, did it create opportunities for students to disclose their barriers more? Could they disclose their motivations to persisting more in an AAM environment? Third, we wanted to see if their participation in these meetings would spark their intent to persist college more, which is a precursor to retention. And then finally, fourth, we wanted to see what the advisors thought of it, because this was a change for the advisors. So what did they think of the implementation? So moving on to the next slide here, this was the sample. We had 14 people involved in it, which was 10 student participants. After students went through two meetings with the AAM model employed in that, then they engaged in about a one-hour semi-structured interview. The academic advisors then participated in a focus group. And let me show you the results that came out of this here on the next slide. So the key findings was that our students were unsure what to expect before coming to their first meeting. These were new students who had never had an advising appointment before. They largely expected either a negative experience or an indifferent experience where somebody was not going to try to get to know them. But when they got to our office and they experienced meetings with the model, they had positive reactions. The key thing was number three is that the rapport that the advisors tried to build with them really helped to reduce a gap between themselves and the advisor because they perceived the advisor to be of a higher rank of them when they first walked in. The disarm, the discover, and the dream phase did prompt them to self-disclose more. Many of them planned to not talk before coming in, but those strategies got them talking more than they had expected or planned to. Our advisors co-constructed a plan, that design phase, with them. But when I asked students in the semi-structured interviews what they remembered from it, many of them couldn't remember the details of the plan that they had put together with the advisor. A majority of students said it did impact their intention to persist at our college. The advisors believed it was a favorable model for student success, but the last bullet point was a key. When we implemented it, they first had some reservations and questioned if it would work in our structure of higher student caseloads. So that leads to this next piece, which is recommendations for practice. First of all, recognizing that our students do come in nervous or expecting an indifferent or impersonal experience, we need to enhance our pre-meeting communication to help to disarm them before they ever walk through the threshold of our door. As administrators, we need to give our advisors time to disarm the students, because that's such a valuable piece of the meetings. Number three, we did a renovation in our office and we tried to make our space more welcoming. Students reacted favorably to that and said the physical space did impact if they were going to self-disclose more or not. Recognize that we didn't do a very good job in the design phase as advisors, and so we need to employ professional development, make sure our advisors really know how to set goals with students and using that SMART goal training. Our advisors were nervous about the implementation, and so in hindsight, we should have used a proven change model to do that implementation instead of simply diving in headfirst. Our institution did not have student advisor assignments, and we're moving to that because of this, so that's an implication. And finally, a relational approach can indeed help to spark students longer at the institution. Thanks, Amanda.
Excellent work, Jim. Thank you. I love just how practical your dissertation and your action research, these practical pieces that you've found. And I find that as you were sharing these, that it's very much reflective of what we're seeing in the literature more broadly speaking. And so again, great work here. Thank you so much. Next, I'd like to invite Dr. Reggie Lewis to share an overview of his study. Reggie.
Thank you, Amanda. My name is Reginald Lewis. I'm the district manager of communications for Tarrant County College in Fort Worth, Texas. We have about six campuses here. And the inspiration for this research was appreciative advising is used on our campus, on our campuses. But yet our graduation rates for African-American males was lagging behind white males, Asian males, and Hispanic males. In fact, African-American males had the lowest graduation rates of any racial or ethnic group. And so the site institution that I used for this particular study actually had some good data, excellent completion rates. And so I wanted to know exactly what they did in order to achieve those particular goals. So next slide, please. So my research question for this qualitative study was, how do African-American males at a Texas community college make sense of their experiences with appreciative advising as it relates to their self-efficacy and persistence towards graduation? And I wanted to center the student voice in this particular study. I know many of the studies that I researched that I saw focused on the advisor perspective, but I wanted to see exactly what the students were experiencing when they interacted with appreciative advisors. So my sample, I conducted semi-structured interviews with six men who identified as African-American or Black, enrolled as full-time degree-seeking students at the research site, met with professional academic advisors at least three times. And that was important because I wanted them to provide some rich data about their experiences. And they were ages 18 and older. And so next slide, we'll take a look at the key findings from this qualitative study. The first theme, superordinate theme that was uncovered was the fact that students wanted caring experiences with an advisor. Care was a term that was utilized throughout the transcripts. They either said the word care, described care in various iterations. The sub themes here when you take a look at those, they're trust, effective communication, and connectedness. And when students had the caring experiences with the advisor, that engendered trust, that impacted the level of communication. It became more effective, two-way communication. Students felt they could proactively reach out to their advisors. And that resulted in them developing a connectedness or a sense of belonging at the institution or with the advisor. The second superordinate theme was feeling empowered, which was something that resonated throughout the transcripts as well. And that was accomplished through either emotional intelligence, which was just a self-awareness of their emotions. A lot of them went into to visit the advisor. They were anxious or, you know, or nervous, as they described before they went in. And afterwards, they felt like they had more control over their academic journey. And so that was very important, those interactions with the academic advisor. And they continued to go back to the advisor for assistance, either with, enrolling in classes, trying to find a job, career selections, things of that nature. And then the second sub-theme was affirmation, encouragement, and advocacy. And this was so important, just hearing things such as, you can accomplish this, or, you know, I'll connect you with the right resources. That was very important to the students. Thirdly, developing confidence, which was very interesting because they desired interdependence. Some of the students initially stated that, you know, they wanted to be their own men, but then they described situations where they really wanted to be guided through either the academic process, you know, as far as enrolling in classes, trying to connect to different resources. So they initially stated that they wanted to be independent, but in actuality, they were striving for interdependence. And then the second sub-theme in this particular category was persistence. Once they felt empowered and confident, obviously that had a positive impact on persistence, their willingness to persist. Lastly, obstacles in improving Black male community college persistence. That was key. There were several barriers that they suggested African-American males have to encounter even before enrolling in school, let alone trying to persist and graduate. So such as low morale, lack of role models, those were some things that came out in the research. And so appreciative advisors actually play a role in connecting students with those resources, whether that's through internships or developing, you know, speaker series, or just sending them information about the various resources at that particular campus, had a positive impact on their self-efficacy and their persistence. Next slide, please. So the implications for practice, the first one was integrate appreciative advising into the orientation program, which was an opportunity for students to, to that connectivity to occur. For example, students can start dreaming about their career, their goals, their academic goals, and they could be connected to resources even before the semester begins, and they can put a face with a name and to have, you know, develop that rapport before the semester starts, so they feel comfortable. They start basically connecting to a caring advisor. The second implication was launch a Summer Bridge program, and the research shows that Summer Bridge programs, especially for minority students, are very successful. And the recommendation was a 2-week program to help students learn about the appreciative advising process, how to utilize it, and what all the resources are available to them at that particular institution. The third one is mandatory advising through graduation. At the site institution, it was not mandatory. It was voluntary. However, once those students developed those caring relationships with the advisor, many of them cited that they would just drop in to have conversations about things that were happening on the weekend, you know, two semesters down the road, you know, how to structure classes, work-life balance, things of that nature. So I believe that if the advising is mandatory, then that will strengthen some of those relationships and those outcomes. And lastly, provide professional development in the appreciative mindset. There was kind of some inconsistencies when it came to the training that the advisors at this institution had, but if the advisors would receive the same professional development, then I believe those outcomes could be improved as well. And that's it for mine.
Thank you so much, Reggie. This was fascinating to learn about your work, and also just reiterating, I think, a recurring theme that we're seeing among these dissertations about the importance of developing relationships with our students and how important that really is. It's so significant to creating and being a vehicle and a conduit to our student success, and more specifically with your study, with how the appreciative advising model can support Black male student success in college. So thank you for your great work. Next, I would like to invite Megan Ellsbury, who is a doctoral candidate hoping to defend by the end of this semester. So Megan, can you give us a sneak preview into your work?
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much. It's an honor to be here with everyone. And like Amanda said, I'm probably a little bit different than some of the other speakers of. I am actually still in the process of writing my findings chapter, but excited to give the world a sneak peek of my study. And kind of what inspired me actually was a class with Dr. Bloom, who really introduced me to the appreciative education and appreciative administration framework. And a light bulb went off in my head. And I said, gosh, these principles, I think, that are innate in who I was and wanted to be as an administrator. And I realized that the power administrators have in creating these environments where students and staff feel valued and cared about. And I wanted to discover more ways to lead in an appreciative way. And I was able to be introduced to this community of educators with similar passions and mindsets that really left me inspired and re-energized and wanting to continue the work and research of appreciative education. Next slide, Amanda. So for my research questions, I really wanted to look at how were educators putting the appreciative education framework into practice. And then also, you know, by putting this into practice, what were the benefits of using this framework, and what are also some of the challenges of using this framework? So with my sample, I actually looked at higher ed administrators who had participated in at least one formal appreciative education training. And so this could have been the appreciative advising online or institute, the appreciative administration online course, and or participated in the Unleashing Greatness retreat. And I also asked that participants had at least one full-time professional reporting to them. And so through my study, I interviewed 21 participants in the height of COVID last summer. I did semi-structured Zoom interviews. I also conducted a focus group with a subgroup of my participants to go over my initial findings. And so I'm really excited to share with you today, again, hot off the presses, of kind of my three themes that have really emerged in what I'm calling the appreciative administration approach to leading others. And first being this establishing trusting relationships. And so this really has been the foundation from my participants. And it's really about providing support, including all voices, really listening and asking powerful questions, and then being able to foster these relationships to achieve personal and organizational goals, and, you know, seeking buy-in, walking side by side with participants. A big one was empowering without micromanagement. To kind of round us off into what George Kuh coined as this positive restlessness. And so this celebration of accomplishments that people are never going to fully arrive. And kind of how do you continue to nurture those relationships? And something for me and why this is not a linear model is that you're going to bounce back and forth. And very similar to the appreciative advising model is this is really something where people are going to be able to use as a toolkit and understand that as you go through things and maybe a new person joins your organization or you go through COVID or changes that happen, you may have to pull out some of these different tools in order to lead appreciatively. So with that, I'm very excited. Again, hopefully in a few months, we'll be able to share the final study with everyone.
So without further ado, I would like to just go over again once again, thank you all for joining us today. And as I was reflecting on what we learned today from our presenters, it occurred to me that, you know, all of our presenters focused on topics that they were passionate about. They were topics that were practical to where they were working, right? As Dr. Harper mentioned, she said, you know, I was given such great advice to look in my own backyard. And what I love is that each of our panelists have become advocates for the student populations that they serve or are in charge of supervising. And what I hope that their work has demonstrated to each of you is the fact that what happens most to students is what happens to them in college. And that we as advisors or in whatever respective role or title you may hold, that you are part of the student experience, you are part of their key to success, and that the relationships that you have the opportunity to establish with your students has potentially that direct impact on their persistence and graduation. So I want to thank you all for caring out loud for your students and for showing up today to be able to learn how others are caring out loud and being able to live that out. We hope that you are all inspired and are reminded that what you do matters. For those of you who may be interested in learning more about the Office of Appreciative Education, we encourage you to bookmark our homepage. You can get to everything that you need directly from our homepage, including all of our offerings, resources, spotlights, and the Journal of Appreciative Education. We have one more webinar coming up on November 4th, and we will be focused on the topic of appreciative mentoring. So we hope that you all might be able to join us. If you aren't able, remember that we record our webinars and we do make them available on our webinar site. So you can go back and actually access our entire library of free webinars to be able to enjoy at your leisure. We want you to save the dates. We have our 2022 Appreciative Advising Institute registrations up. We will be hosting one in May, June, and July this year. So we hope that you and or members of your team will be able to join us. We also have registration open for our Spring 2022 Appreciative Advising online course, as well as our Appreciative Administration online course. So we would love for those of you who are either in administrative positions or aspire to move into administrative positions to consider joining us for this course. We also, if you've been through the Institute or have completed the Appreciative Advising online course and have not yet become a certified Appreciative Advisor, we'd like to invite and challenge you to pursue certification. And if we can answer any questions, we're happy to do that. The application is available online and you can learn about how to get registered and what the fee is for that. And most importantly, as I've already mentioned, we want to invite you to join in our campaign to intentionally care out loud this academic year, as we have, many of us have returned to campuses, moving through the pandemic. Now more than ever, I think our students and one another need to know that we have our advocates and that we have people who care out loud, because we know that our interactions with others changes the atmosphere, it changes the environment, and it helps us create spaces where we want to be, where we can learn at our best, work at our best, and be our best. So please join us in our Care Out Loud campaign. We encourage you to nominate those who have cared out loud. Help us to make this go viral and spread the word. We're sending out certificates to those in recognition who have cared out loud, and you'll get a recognition as well for nominating someone. So we look forward to staying in touch with you. We look forward to hearing you care out loud, and we'll look forward to seeing you at an upcoming webinar or offering. Without further ado, feel free to log off. We hope you have a great rest of your day, a great rest of your week, a great rest of your fall semester, and please keep in touch. Thanks, everybody.